We are going to talk about digital communications in this course, and but the very name implies that information is transmitted in a digital form. Now, in many applications, information is naturally available in a digital form. For example, information coming from computers. If it has to be conveyed from one place to another place, is directly available in a digital form. In a binary 1-0 form or whatever. But in many situations, the information of interest is not naturally in the digital form, right? For example, most of the message signals that we are working with normally in our day-to-day life are not really digital signals. They're not in the form of ones and zeros. Some are, but many are not. The voice signal through which I'm conveying messages to you is an analog signal. The picture signal that you may want to convey also is an analog signal. Many of the telemetry signals that you have to work with when you are making measurements at a distance are also analog signals. So all these applications, we are interested in communicating information, but the information is not naturally in a digital form. Now, in all these applications, before we can make use of digital communication techniques, we need to first bring the information into a digital form so that we can use digital communication. One of the requirements before we can use digital communication is to have a technique by which the information of interest, if analog, has to be brought into the digital form. Right? Now, there are various kinds of techniques for doing this. They are broadly classified as digital pulse modulation techniques. I believe you at least have heard of analog pulse modulation techniques, if not done it in your class. If you have not done it in the class, we'll take it up separately in that extra slot. But if you have done, or if you have at least heard, you must have heard of things like pulse amplitude modulation, pulse width modulation, and pulse position modulation. Basically, in analog pulse modulation schemes, you use a pulse train as a carrier, as against the sinusoidal carrier that you are familiar with for normal analog modulations. Right? So here the carrier is in the form of a train of pulses, and the parameter, some parameter of the pulse train is picked up for modulation, for conveying the information. Typically, it could be the amplitude, it could be the pulse width, which is made to vary in proportion to the signal, or it could be the position of successive pulses with respect to some reference frame of positions that is made variable or proportional to the message signal. And we can take up the discussion of these if required in a separate class. In digital pulse modulations, instead of making some of these parameters analogously dependent on the message signal, the message signal sample value as sampled by any of these pulses is represented in a discrete form. Therefore, that's the essential difference between analog and digital. Analog is essentially a continuous thing, and digital is essentially a discrete thing. So you use a pulse train again, as in analog modulations, but the information conveyed by the parameter, let's say the amplitude, is not a continuous amplitude. It's a discrete valued amplitude. That's the essential difference. It could have a finite number of discrete values. The samples of the pulses can go through a finite number of discrete values rather than a continuous set of values over either a finite or an infinite interval, right? Basically, that's the difference between analog and digital pulse modulation schemes. In analog, we have continuous variations possible. In digital, only discrete variations are permitted. Is that okay? Please feel free to interrupt if you have any doubts. Now, there are two primary kinds of digital pulse modulation schemes that we'll do. There are two generic kinds of pulse modulation schemes. One is called delta modulation. And the other is called pulse code modulation. Okay. Now, of these, delta modulation is very simple to implement, extremely simple to mechanize. And therefore, we'll consider delta modulation first. So, let us start by discussing delta modulation. It's a very simple technique to encode a message signal into a binary two-valued signal, where each pulse sample takes only one of two possible polarities, positive or negative. And for the sake of discussion, I'll assume that the pulses that we're talking about are ideal impulses, just for simplicity of bringing out the concepts. This is a block diagram of a simple delta modulator. As I describe it, maybe you can copy it if you want to. It's a very standard picture which is available. Is it readable? I'll explain. The input to this system is a message empty which you want to represent in a digital form. All right? Now, this is compared with a reference signal MST, M sub ST, which is being somehow generated within this block, and we'll see how it is being generated, what is the nature of MST in a few minutes. Right? So, basically, you look at these two signals and take the difference of these two signals, which are denoted by DT. So, DT here denotes the difference between MT and MST. So, let me write it here maybe. DT is MT minus M sub ST, where M sub ST is a reference waveform which is internally being generated by the system. This difference signal is hard limited. I hope you understand what I mean by the term hard limited. That is, this goes to a block whose output becomes plus 1 if DT is positive and becomes minus 1 if DT is negative. That's the operation of hard limitation, right?
So, what if it is 0?
Well, we never go through a 0. We are assuming that DT is always positive or negative. I mean, always non-zero, always positive or negative. And in real life systems, one doesn't really have to worry about it too much. And this hard limited signal is being denoted by delta t. All right?
Delta?
Delta as a function of t. So d is being transformed to delta. D is an analog signal, analog difference signal, and delta is obviously a binary valued, discrete valued signal. Again, it's a representation of the same difference signal, but it's gone through a nonlinear operation of hard limitation. This delta t is being multiplied with an impulse train, as you can see, coming from a pulse generator or impulse generator. Mathematically, that is represented as sigma delta t minus n t sub s, where t sub s represents the period of the impulse train, right? So these two are being multiplied, and that is the output of your delta modulator. So the difference signal delta t, the hard limited difference signal delta t, multiplies this impulse train and produces the delta modulator output. So therefore, what is the nature of the delta modulator output? It's a sequence of positive and negative impulses, right? Each impulse that is going out is either of a positive amplitude of a fixed value or a corresponding amplitude but with a difference negative polarity, all right? Now, the same delta modulated signal is taken also to generate the reference waveform MST by a simple integration of this through this process. Let us see how we can interpret this MST. Let's look at the delta modulated signal XCT. You can write this as the product of delta T and the impulse train delta T minus NTS, right? Where delta T is signal of delta DT. Is that okay? I can remove this sheet.
What is the signal of DT? What is
signal of DT? Signal is, you are familiar with the signal function? That is, if DT is positive, delta t is plus 1, if dt is negative, delta t is minus 1. That's a mathematical representation of hard limitation, all right? Fine? Okay. Or I can also write xct as equal to, just take the thing inside. Because when I multiply any function like delta t, even if t is continuous, but I'm multiplying it with a delta function, I need to really only worry about the values of the function at t equal to nts, the sampling instance, right? So which is essentially a series of impulses, series of positive and negative impulses. And whether it is positive or negative will depend on whether the difference signal is positive or negative, right? At the sampling instance. Difference signal as sampled in the sampling instance. That is what is really important. Now let's look at the reference signal MST, which is essentially the integral of XCT. Let me write it as XC alpha d alpha integrated up to t, which you can write as delta NTS integral of delta alpha minus NTS d alpha. Okay? Straightforward substitution, and taking the integral inside because delta NTS doesn't depend on t. What is this? How do you interpret this? You can interpret this. What will be each of these impulse functions after integration? It will become a unit step function, right? So basically, you have sigma delta NTS multiplied by unit step functions located at NTS, multiples of TS, right? So what will this create? This will essentially create a staircase kind of waveform, in fact, a staircase kind of approximation to your original signal MT. Right? Let me illustrate by an example here. I'll come back to this line. If you have noted this for the moment, I'm removing it, and that is what you have. This is your original message signal MT, and this staircase kind of waveform that you are seeing is the integrated signal or the reference signal MST. And the waveform at the bottom is the output of your delta modulator. This is XCT. So this is your delta modulated signal, a sequence of positive and negative impulses. Let's go through this waveform a bit carefully and see that indeed this kind of behavior conforms to the diagram that we have just discussed. Let's say at this instant, this is your reference waveform MT, this is the value, and this is the value of the this is the input signal, this is the reference value signal, and you are taking the difference MT minus MST, and therefore the polarity is negative, right? And therefore you produce a negative impulse at the output, right? That negative impulse after integration becomes a negative step, right? That negative step continues, and at this next sampling instant, this is compared with this. So you look at MT minus MST again, which is now positive, and therefore a positive impulse is created, which is integrated again to produce a positive step, right? You all follow this? And this process continues. And this process then generates a reference waveform, which is essentially a staircase approximation to your original continuous signal MT, right? Also, it simultaneously produces the delta modulator output, which is a sequence of positive and negative impulses. So that's a simple process of digitization. You have to start with a continuous signal varying in any arbitrary manner, but this XCT is a representation of the same continuous signal. Why is it? We can consider XCT to be a digital representation of MT. Why? Because from this digital representation, I can reconstruct a staircase approximation of the original continuous signal. Agreed? By a simple operation of integration. So given this XCT, I can obtain MST, which is some kind of an approximation of MT. Of course, I have to make sure through appropriate design that MST is a good approximation of MT. And we should also understand under what situations it is a good approximation and when we'll have problems, right? Given those problems, which we'll have to understand, within those constraints, this seems like a reasonable way of converting a continuous time analog signal into a discrete time binary valued digital signal. A simple way of doing it. In fact, as you can see, the only components that are needed are a comparator, integrator, and some kind of a simple modulator, pulse modulator, right? Which are all very simple things to implement, extremely easy to mechanize. And as far as demodulation is concerned, it is trivial. Given this, at the other end, all you need is an integrator, because that will produce this. Of course, you may like to do some kind of a smoothening of this MST so as to produce a nice approximation to MT. And a simple low-pass filtering operation is usually adequate for that purpose. So the demodulator will consist of the integrator followed by an appropriate low-pass filter so as to smoothen the output. Okay? Now, we said that we must produce a good approximation, right? And to produce a good approximation, we must understand what kind of problems might arise in this situation. Problems with this simple delta modulator. There are a few problems. In fact, there are some serious problems. Problems and difficulties. Primarily, I would say there are two kinds of problems, and they are both slightly contradictory to each other. One is called slope overload problem, and the other is called the granular noise problem. Okay, let's look at what these problems are and how they are created. Okay, I think we can look at here itself. Consider first the slope overload problem. You are approximating a continuous waveform MT with a staircase approximation, right? And a staircase approximation has a basic limitation. It can build up at a maximum possible rate, which is governed by two factors. What are these?
Sampling rate
and the step size and the sampling interval. Because there is a limit on the maximum slope you can generate from a staircase of these two fixed parameters, right? The maximum value of the slope that you can have, in fact, is equal to delta 0 upon Ts, where delta 0 is the step size. Agreed? And the step size will depend on the amplitude of the impulses that are going out, the strength of impulses that are going out, right? Because the impulses are being integrated to obtain the steps, right? The stronger the impulses, the larger the steps, the weaker the impulses, the smaller the steps, right? But once you have fixed the impulse strength, the step size is fixed in that particular delta modulator, and it is going to be constant. And it is constant, let that constant value be delta 0, and the maximum slope that you can build up is obviously delta 0 by Ts.
But sir, a larger step will mean more error?
Largest?
Larger step.
The question is, will a larger step
mean more error?
More error.
Yeah. I mean, when you are trying to approximate, suppose you go from a lower value to a higher value.
Yeah. Let's talk about one problem at a time. You're quite right. The obvious solution is that if you want to avoid the slope overload problem, you increase the step size, and what you are saying is, if you do that, that will create more error.
Yeah.
Indeed, that is correct, and that is in fact the second kind of problem that we are going to talk about, the granular noise problem. Right. So these two problems are, if you try to improve one, the other one gets worse. This is precisely what I was going to tell you in a few minutes. But let me come back to it. Let's first, at the moment, limit ourselves to the slope overload problem, and we'll come back to the second problem in a few minutes. You all at least appreciate the problem of slope overload now, why it occurs. I have got this captured on this diagram here nicely, which shows a situation where your message signal MT has this kind of a nature, a unit step kind of a nature, right? And obviously at the point of change, you have a very large slope, in fact infinite slope, right? Your delta modulator, which was approximating this waveform like this before the step came along, suddenly finds the slope to be too much and cannot track that slope. It can only go as a staircase of the maximum possible slope governed by its step size and its sampling interval. Eventually, it is able to track on to the new level, but there is a time span over which it is not able to track the waveform because of the slope overload situation. This is the error signal. The error signal looks like this. In this time span, you have a large error. Eventually, it again becomes small, but there is a finite time span over which the error is very large, and that is due to slope overload. So you can see that the duration of the error due to the slope overload obviously will depend on these two parameters, the step size and the sampling interval. There are two ways to reduce this: either increase your step size or increase your sampling rate, right? Decrease the sampling interval. Okay, so both the thing, both the options are available to us. Do you need to look at this diagram and write properly, or it's okay? Let's look at another kind of message signal. I have looked at the unit step kind of message signal here. Let's look at another kind of message signal, the more standard kind that you normally deal with. Let's take a sinusoidal message. Here, your message MT is of the kind, let us say, A sine 2 pi f1 t, where f1 is some appropriate frequency. Dm by dt, the slope at time t, is given by 2 pi times A times f1 cosine 2 pi f1 t. Alright? And the largest value of the slope that you can encounter for such a message signal is obviously the maximum value is 2 pi A times F1. So it depends on two things. It depends on the amplitude of the sinusoid, and it also depends on the frequency of the sinusoid. Right? For larger frequencies, you will get a larger value of the maximum possible slope for a fixed amplitude. Right? Therefore, if you want a wide slope overload for a sinusoidal signal, what you have to do is make sure that your delta modulator that you design has a combination of step size and sampling interval Ts such that delta 0 by Ts is greater than or equal to 2 pi times AF1. Right? This is the condition that you must satisfy to avoid slope overload. Clear? Any questions? This is a necessary condition so that MST follows MT faithfully when a large step comes along, or for it to be able to track the maximum possible slope that it is likely to encounter in the sinusoid. Alright? Very good. Now, let's just discuss this a few different way. Let me raise the question of sampling here. Ts is some kind of a sampling pulse. I mean, is a sampling period in your delta modulator, right? You are familiar with sampling theorem. Now, when you normally sample a signal and create a signal like PEM signal or something by sampling, you know that you have to be governed by the so-called Nyquist criteria, right? The sampling interval should be greater than twice the maximum frequency contained in the signal. Let me ask, maximum frequency contained in the message.
Sampling frequency.
Intervals.
The sampling frequency should be greater than twice the highest frequency in the message. Right. Absolutely right. What do you think should be the value of Ts here? Should it be of the same order or different order? Can you make an intelligent guess?
It should be different.
Should it be lower or should it be higher?
So 1 by Ts should be larger than the same.
Should the sampling rate be higher in delta modulator than the Nyquist rate, or should it be lower? That is a question.
Higher.
It should be higher. Why? so as to create a so as to further eliminate the possibility of slow power. See, what are we trying to track here by sampling? We are tracking the difference signal, right? The difference signal, what is the difference signal? It is basically some kind of a derivative, it is a representation of the derivative of the signal, because you are taking differential of the signals over small intervals of time, right? So it is going to be proportional to the derivative of the signal. The bandwidth of the derivative of the signal in general will be much larger than the signal, than that of the signal itself. So for an appropriate, adequate representation of that signal, you will typically require much larger sampling rates. That is the intuitive picture, why you require large sampling rates. Of course, the more exact picture is here, given by the slope overload condition, right? The sampling rate that you should use is such that for the maximum frequency that you have, F1 let us say, for the maximum amplitude that that frequency may have, right? The step size and the sampling interval should be related in this pair. So this is some kind of a design equation for your delta modulator, a very important design equation. Now you may say that if you want to reduce the slope overload problem, you can simply increase delta 0, the step size. You can do that, because the moment you do that, you will have the capacity to track larger slopes and go up to higher frequencies or larger amplitudes of the sinusoids, right? However, this makes it difficult to track slow variations or small variations. For example, suppose we have a signal like that. Let me just complete this, then I will come back to your question. And we have a large step size. You will never be able to track any slow variations. Okay? So all these variations of the signal are killed, because you will have, as far as the low pass filter output of this will be concerned, it will be more or less a constant value. Okay, in this interval.
So basically you want a small step and a very high sampling rate.
Or we have to increase the sampling rate, which also you will have some limit. I mean, let's say you have some limitation on the maximum sampling rate that you can use, then at that sampling rate, the only thing you can do further beyond that is increase the step size. Okay? Yes, now can I come back to your question, please? Is it answered? So, suppose I want to take care of both the things. That is, this incidentally, this problem, that is the inability of the delta modulator to track small variations or slow variations due to a large step size, is precisely the second problem that I mentioned at the beginning. This is called the granular noise problem. Okay, that is, you have a kind of noise which is there and it does not represent any kind of variations in the signal, right? Small variations in the signal are just killed due to this kind of noise, okay? And this becomes more serious if your step size is large. So ideally, it gives us some kind of an idea, intuitive idea as to what we should do to build a different kind of delta modulator which will have less serious versions of both these problems, both the slope overload problem and the granular noise problem. That is, one which is able to track fast or rapid changes, as well as one which is able to track slow or small changes, right? That's what I would like. I mean, if in a signal we don't know at what time you'll have small variations or slow variations and what time you'll have rapid variations, and we like to be able to take care of all kinds of situations. How do we do it? Now, an ideal answer would be yes.
So you use the word slow, so shouldn't we just small? will it really matter if it is slow or
fast? Well, they are related. If it is small, it will also be slow if you're talking of a fixed time span, right? So it's in a loose sense that I'm speaking, slow or small, but they are related. If a small variation takes place in a fixed interval of time, it is also slow. While if a large variation takes place in a fixed interval of time, it is also rapid, right? So in a very loose sense, I'm talking about the similarity between slow and small. Is that okay? Let me come back to the point that I was trying to make. Therefore, ideally, we should have a system in which we should have a small step size if we are having slow variations in the signal, and we should have a large step size if we are encountering rapid variations in the signal. So if you could build a system which could do that, we could avoid both slope overload and granular noise, right? And that is precisely what you are able to do by a variation of a delta modulator, which is called adaptive delta modulator. Idea is extremely simple. The step size is no longer kept fixed. It is made to vary or made to adapt with the nature of the signal, right? So delta zero is made small. When MT is nearly constant or has small variations, small or slow or whatever. It's made larger if MT is changing rapidly. Okay? And one possible way by which you can do this is a modification of the delta modulator shown here. Everything is just about the same as it was earlier, with one small difference. And the difference is, I've introduced here a variable gain amplifier in the feedback path. Okay? Everything else is same. This variable gain amplifier is an addition in this system. What does this variable gain amplifier do? It changes the impulse strength that is going into the integrator, right? By multiplying the impulse by a gain, you're changing the impulse strength, and therefore it is able to change the step size after integration. Is that okay? The gain itself is controlled, because it's variable gain, it has to be controlled somehow by an electrical voltage, which is also being generated from the delta modulator output. This is a control signal. Going into the variable gain amplifier. This control signal will decide whether the gain is large or small. Okay? When the gain is large, the step size will be large. When the gain is small, the step size will be small. And what we would like to do is that the gain should be large when rapid changes are taking place, and gain should be small when slow variations or small changes are taking place. To understand, therefore, what we must do, let's look at the picture that we had seen earlier. I'll come back to this picture in a minute. Okay. This block here says square law or modulus device. I have indicated a modulus symbol here. And this one is a low pass filter. Right? Remember, this was a situation of small variations. what is the delta modulator output is going to be? A sequence of positive and negative impulses, right? For this kind of situation, we are going to have a sequence of positive and negative impulses, one after another. Alternate impulses are going to be of different polarity. When we are undergoing a small variation and you have a large step size, this is what is likely to happen. And what we would like to do is, in this situation, reduce the step size, right? So when the delta modulator finds this situation happening, this situation present, that alternate impulses are positive and negative, you can interpret it to mean that the existing step size is too large. We must reduce it, right? Agreed?
But say the limiter output is at a certain level, where are we reducing the step size?
The step size is being controlled by the variable gain amplifier.
So how will it control
the step size? Actually, the measure of the
okay.
Why will you necessarily
the step size is dependent on the size of
one person at a time, please. One.
Limiter is there, so
all right. I think you have to still understand the operation of the adaptive delta modulator. Please try to understand this. Nothing is changing here. These are of fixed amplitude. They have to be of fixed amplitude because we can only allow two levels. The output of XCT must be only binary valued. We cannot have variable values at the output of the delta modulator.
Demodulator we will do.
But within the demodulator,
yes.
I have provision for a changing the impulse strength that is coming from the delta modulator output. Right?
So that is the same block will be used in the demodulator.
Of course. The demodulator, I will come to the demodulator later. At the moment, I am only trying to understand how to track rapid as well as slow variations, right? Obviously, the feedback portion will also become your demodulator later, right?
So, a better way would have been to directly take the derivative of the MT and then have that to control the gain, because this is an indirect way of basically getting the derivative. What you are doing is this crude way of low pass filter smoothing thing. I mean, first you have the difference which is approximately the derivative, then you smoothen it using the LPF, and then basically you are applying that to control.
Let me ask you, when you say I should take the derivative, how do you go about doing it?
So in a simple
should be in the
this is precisely what we are doing here. The whole idea of an adaptive delta modulator is, or a delta modulator for that matter, is that indirectly it is taking the derivative as well as creating the modulated signal, and within that framework we want to have a very simple implementation.
So why don't
implementation.
Have a direct
analog? The whole idea is that to be able to have a very simple mechanism which is sensitive to the nature of the signal, right? And this is able to do it. Incidentally, this is obviously not a unique implementation. Many possible variations of this implementation are there and are possible. Right, and we can consider some of those which you are suggesting separately, but we would like something which is within the feedback loop, right, for various reasons. So because we would like to have a closed loop system, part of which also serves as a demodulator, right? All these conditions are nicely satisfied by this system, which may be difficult to satisfy if you are not doing things in a different this way, but not necessarily. You can always come up with a different way of doing things which will work as well. But have you understood the operation? We were trying to understand the operation of this, and to towards that, what I was trying to suggest that when the delta modulator produces an alternate sequence of positive and negative impulses, this system will interpret it to mean that the step size that as it exists is too large and it must be made small, right? And therefore, what must be done in this system is to reduce the value of this control signal, right? And that's precisely what will happen, because this low pass filter will produce an output which is in this period where the output is a sequence of positive and negative impulses, it will produce a nearly zero DC kind of value, right? Small value.
How is the single impulse is going to lead to that?
No, a low pass filter is essentially some kind of an integrator over a certain period of time, right? So suppose it's looking at this time constant. Its time constant is about this much. So it's looking at a sequence of 4 or 5 or 6 impulses and looking at the average value, which is going to be, very small, because alternate impulses are positive and negative. They're going to cancel each other's effect. Right? There's no need to that. At the moment, I just want to give you a concept. Okay? We can go into implementation details later.
So how fast is this response? After how many such things it decides that it is a
constant? That is a design parameter, and that is what will decide the time constant of your low-pass filter. The low-pass filter that you must design should be such that it is able to do this over the required number of sequence of alternate impulses, right? Positive and negative impulses. But those are matters of details which at the moment I'm skipping, because I just want to introduce the concept to you. I'm not going into that much detail at the moment. On the other hand, if you have a slope overload situation of this kind, right? This is a slope overload situation. What will you get as a delta modulator output here? A long sequence of positive impulses, or a long sequence of negative impulses. For example, if the step was in the other direction, you would get a long sequence of negative impulses. So in that case, the low pass filter average value output will be large in magnitude, but of course it could have any sign, positive or negative. And that's the reason, immediately followed by the low pass filter, I have a scalar device or a modulus device, because I'm not interested to know whether the difference is, whether the error is large positive or large negative. I know that it is large, and therefore I must increase the step size. The slope overload exists, I must increase the step size. And therefore the control signal becomes large, and the variable gain amplifier gain is increased. Step size is increased, and that's the basic principle of an adaptive delta modulator.
So when these are alternating, how will we reduce the step size? I mean, the low-pass filter is giving a DC, so how are we reducing the step size?
That DC signal, the small DC signal, results in a small value of the gain, because it's controlling the gain. And the manner of controlling the gain is that when the control signal is small, the gain is made small. When the control signal is large, the gain is made large. That's all. It's controlling the gain of this amplifier. This is a control signal only. Right? After all, you need some parameter which to indicate whether this kind of condition exists or that kind of condition exists. And based on that, you have to take action in the form of changing the gain of the amplifier appropriately. That indication is coming to you through this control signal. Fine? And as far as the receiver is concerned, obviously the receiver is going to be precisely just this. Take this out at the other end and use this as a receiver. Because there is
probably you're smoothening this thing after the integrator.
Of course, after the integrator you can have a further step of smoothing through an appropriate low-pass filter. Okay? So this finishes my discussion on basic principles of delta modulation and adaptive delta modulation. We can take up some of the issues that you have raised in the class tomorrow that we will have.